I'm glad somebody has asked this question.
This is where the magic happens.
This is primarily a question and answer show. So if any of you out there would like to ask questions.
Hi. Welcome to our latest Maps Developer Live event. This week we are talking with Raleigh Seamster from the Google Earth Outreach team. I'm Mano Marks. This is Raleigh right here, and we apologize for getting a little bit of a late start. Raleigh is from, as I mentioned, the Google Earth Outreach team, and she just organized a really amazing event last week called Geo for Good. So we asked her to come in this week to talk to us about what happened. So Raleigh, can you talk a little bit about what Google Earth Outreach is and what the Geo for Good event was?
Sure. So Google Earth Outreach is a program which helps nonprofits and public benefit organizations use Google Maps in order to visualize their cause and message to the world. And as part of the program, we offer a lot of different things. We offer software grants to nonprofits. We offer trainings both online and in person, as well as many other resources on our website. And so what we were doing last week was holding a 3-day workshop that we called the Geo for Good User Summit. Now, since we launched in 2006, we've held many, many different trainings all over the world of different types. And this summit was the first of its kind. It was a special event. And the purpose of this summit, usually we're working with groups that may not be as familiar with Google's mapping tools. But this time around, we were bringing kind of our nonprofits we know, different Hall of Famer nonprofits that have already produced amazing work in Google Earth and Maps, as well as some new ones. And we were bringing them here to Google headquarters in Mountain View to refresh them in all the amazing developments in these products that have happened over the last couple of years, as well as some completely new tools like Google Maps Engine and Google Earth Engine. So the basic structure of the summit was to have hands-on sessions in all of these different tools, as well as breakout sessions, giving participants the opportunity to explore and do deeper dives on topics like KML coding and Maps API.
Cool. So we have actually here a few demos that Raleigh has identified of from participants in the summit. So we just want to go through a few of these. This first one here, if we can put that up, is from Living Oceans. And why don't you tell us a little bit about what the purpose of the site is?
Yeah, sure. So Living Oceans Society, their mission is to protect British Columbia's Pacific coastline. And so they work a lot on topics of marine planning and conservation. And they had all of these amazing maps on paper. And so they've been doing a lot with Google tools in order to put these maps online so both stakeholders and the public can explore. And this map in particular is an example of how they've used Google Maps Engine in order to bring in different map layers onto the same map. It has this nice widget that lets you turn layers off and on and understand what they mean. And then you can click on the individual points to explore more information. So it's very interactive, and they have this embedded right on their website.
So here you can see it's got interesting layers, kayak routes, ferry routes, incidents where there were vessels, protected areas, and you can turn those on and off, and you see they display here. So this is using the Maps API, and it's using fusion table layers to render a number of these different data layers, and you can see how you can just sort of turn those on and off. Let's take a look at I Love Mountains.
So this is another example of a great organization we've been working with since the beginning of our program. Appalachian Voices is a nonprofit based in Appalachia that works to raise public awareness about coal mining's impact on the region. They've done a number of different projects over the year, and this one in particular is using Maps API to display data layers that they're pulling in from various national data sets about the impacts of coal mining on health in the region. So what you see right now, for example, is data on life expectancy, a change by county in Appalachia. And if you can see it, there's kind of a green markings where coal mining is happening. And then the red indicates the areas in which the life expectancy has lowered by a great percentage. And so you can really overlay these two data sets using Maps API and see how the data correlates.
Right. So they're using, I believe, KML layers to render the different regions where the the individual sort of the chloropath maps, basically the individual areas where you see differences in life expectancy, and you see where red is, you actually see this decrease of half a year to a year, and dark red, such as in this region, of more than a year in the last decade. So in the last decade, people living in these areas have lost basically a year of expectancy from their life. They've got other data ranges here. So you've got overall well-being, birth defect indexes, and a whole bunch of other stuff. And you can see overall well-being for a pretty big swath of this area has just dramatically dropped. And I just really like this as a nice, very clean, easy to use and understand way to tell the story about mountaintop removal.
Exactly. And they do, if you see above, there's a get embed code, and they do a great job of making their maps shareable across the web.
Right. So you can have a share embed code here, and it's just an iframe. It's like putting a video in your blog or putting a map right in your blog. Yeah, really nice, nice way to pull that all together. Let's take a look at Eyes on the Forest here.
Sure. This is a project from the last year. And what's interesting about this is that WWF and Indonesian nonprofit called Eyes on the Forest.
WWF is a
World Wildlife Fund. Yeah, thank you. And they're basically, what they're doing is they're working to protect wildlife in Sumatra. There's a lot of really unique animal species there, such as the Sumatran tiger, rhinos, and elephants. And the palm oil production and pulp paper industry on the island are very quickly deforesting and degrading the natural habitats that these animals live in. And they were looking for a way to really communicate this message to CEOs of companies that buy the paper and buy the palm oil and show the impact that this is having on the island. So what they did is they brought all of their data sets about wildlife habitat ranges, carbon stocks, forest ranges, protected areas, and stored it in Google Maps Engine. And then they're using Google Maps API as kind of the front end, the interface through which the public can explore these data layers. Mm-hmm. And it's quite, Mano's gonna show you in a minute, but it's quite interesting because there's kind of a pullout menu that when you hover over a certain data set, it tells you more about that data set. So it's really geared towards explaining to the public kind of these complicated data sets.
Right, so as you can see here from the map, if I hover over, say, the Sumatran rhinoceros, it tells me a lot about what's going on there, and a lot about the rhinos and how they are critically endangered. And you can also select the different sort of the wildlife ranges. You can see in 2007 and then 1980s. And this follows a fairly similar pattern we saw in a number of these different sites where you have this kind of left nav where you you pull up individual data layers, because there's so much data, you want to be able to give the user an interactivity that allows them to select what they're viewing and what they're not. And I particularly like that they're using using Maps Engine with the Google Maps API, because that allows them to display just really large amounts of data. Now, Google Maps Engine is, for those of you who don't know, it's a new serving technology from Google. We released it last year, and it's basically storing all your GIS data and then serving it out over Google's infrastructure, and it's allows people to use both use the Maps API, but also to use their native data formats. So you can upload shapefiles or KML files or whatever GIS data formats that you have, both vector and raster data, upload them to Maps Engine, and then serve that. We handle all the serving out of that data. And you can obviously combine it with our data as well.
And the cool thing to note about Google Maps Engine is that eligible nonprofits can apply for a grant of Google Maps Engine through the Google Earth Outreach program, and we'll share with you some links as to how you find out more information about that.
Right. We'll put links in the description of the video once it's posted. Let's take a look at this Living Oceans site here.
So again, Living Oceans Society, they're working to communicate different marine planning issues to the public. Mm-hmm. And this site is an example of using the Google Earth plugin API in order to share different data layers on the map. So they have that left-hand nav that you can turn on and off layers. But the cool thing is, since they're using the Earth API, you can tilt and rotate and kind of explore in the 3D view.
Right. And so you can see here, turning on and off layers within the Earth API, and you can just get this real nice sense of the ocean. You can also even, I'd like to see them put some something under the ocean, because you can actually go under the ocean with the Earth API and see things on the forest, on the ocean floor. I don't think we have a lot of good terrain data down there in this particular region yet. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it makes for a very nice, smooth experience and allows you to display a lot of data directly in the browser.
We find that using Google Earth resonates especially with environmental organizations that are working with issues dealing with the land and the landscape, and they love being able to use Google Earth's rich terrain and 3D imagery in order to communicate those issues to the public.
Right, and then have that on the plugin right in their website allows them to have a nice, smooth 3D experience. And I wanted to show one map that I showed. This is actually just a sample that I developed. There's a organization called Save the Elephants, and they produce a GPX track of one particular elephant over a year period in this park within Kenya. And you can see on here that I took the GPX track and loaded it into the browser and then just parsed it as XML. Using our new heat map and symbols capabilities that we put into the Google Maps API this summer. So the heat map is a layer, and the symbols are symbols on polylines in this case, but also on markers. So you can, let me zoom in a little bit here. You can see I actually put a little symbol of an elephant on the line, and I'm animating it as it's moving around the line. So you can see the little elephant moving there. And basically what we do is we allow you to do custom symbols on maps using SVG paths. So we then parse those SVG paths, render them into canvas, and overlay them on top of the map. And here I'm just changing the position every few seconds. I'm changing the position of the symbol along the line, just a very small incremental percentage. But I can turn that on and off. I can interact basically with this dynamically. I can change the color, because this is all happening in the browser. It happens very quickly. It's all rendered in the browser. I can turn on and off the heat map as well. And in this case, we used I also used arrows on the lines between the waypoints. So I just added a symbol, a repeating symbol that repeats every I think it was 100 pixels on the line, and you can see an arrow that basically tells you the direction that that elephant was going at that particular time between different waypoints. So that was that then turned into a breakout session where that was mostly what I talked about during that session. Any last minute thoughts, Raleigh?
I guess if you're interested to know more about what nonprofits are doing with Google Maps, Google Maps API, Google Earth, head to our website, earth.google.com/outreach, and we have tons of case studies and examples there. We have a section where you can read about our software grants. So if you are at a nonprofit or are working with a nonprofit, you can encourage them to apply for a grant if needed. We also have a developer marketplace where developers that like working with nonprofits and are looking for work with nonprofits can list themselves in a marketplace. We also have a page of training resources. So if you're a developer working with nonprofits and you want to give them some basic training on how to use these tools, we have materials that can help you do that.
Great. Well, thanks for coming in and talking to us today. Raleigh, and we'll post links to a lot of these samples and to the Earth Outreach resources in the video and on our Google Plus page. So
fantastic.
Thanks everybody for watching.
Yeah, thank you.